Leviathan. By Thomas Hobbes. Part I. Continues. Chapter X of Power, Worth, Dignity, Honor and Worthiness. Power. The power of a man, to take it universally, is his present means, to obtain some future apparent good. And is either original, or instrumental. Natural power, is the eminence of the faculties of body, or mind, as extraordinary strength, for me, prudence, arts, eloquence, liberality, nobility. Instrumental are those powers, which acquired by these, or by fortune, are means and instruments to acquire more, as riches, reputation, friends, and the secret working of God, which men call good luck. For the nature of power, is in this point, like to fame, increasing as it proceeds, or like the motion of heavy bodies, which the further they go, make still the more haste. The greatest of humane powers, is that which is compounded of the powers of most men, united by consent, in one person, natural or civil, that has the use of all their powers depending on his will, such as is the power of a commonwealth, or depending on the wills of each particular, such as is the power of a faction, or of divers factions leagued. Therefore to have servants, is power, to have friends, is power, for they are strengths united. Also riches joined with liberality, is power, because it procureth friends, and servants, without liberality, not so, because in this case they defend not, but expose men to envy, as a prey. Reputation of power, is power, because it draweth with it the adherence of those that need protection. So is reputation of love of a man's country, called popularity, for the same reason. Also, what quality soever make the man beloved, or feared of many, or the reputation of such quality, is power, because it is a means to have the assistance, and service of many. Good success is power, because it make the reputation of wisdom, or good fortune, which makes men either fear him, or rely on him. Affability of men already in power, is increase of power, because it gaineth love. Reputation of prudence in the conduct of peace or war, is power, because to prudent men, we commit the government of ourselves, more willingly than to others. Nobility is power, not in all places, but only in those commonwealths, where it has privileges, for in such privileges consisteth their power. Eloquence is power, because it is seeming prudence. For me is power, because being a promise of good, it recommendeth men to the favor of women and strangers. The sciences, are small power, because not eminent, and therefore, not acknowledged in any man, nor are at all, but in a few, and in them, but of a few things. For science is of that nature, as none can understand it to be, but such as in a good measure have attained it. Arts of public use, as fortification, making of engines, and other instruments of war, because they confer to defense, and victory, our power, and though the true mother of them, be science, namely the mathematics, yet, because they are brought into the light, by the hand of the artificer, they be esteemed, the midwife passing with the vulgar for the mother, as his issue. Worth. The value, or worth of a man, is as of all other things, his price, that is to say, so much as would be given for the use of his power, and therefore is not absolute, but a thing dependent on the need and judgment of another. An able conductor of soldiers, is of great price in time of war present, or imminent, but in peace not so. A learned and uncorrupt judge, is much worth in time of peace, but not so much in war. And as in other things, so in men, not the seller, but the buyer determines the price. For let a man, as most men do, rate themselves as the highest value they can, yet their true value is no more than it is esteemed by others. The manifestation of the value we set on one another, is that which is commonly called honoring, and dishonoring. To value a man at a high rate, is to honor him, at a low rate, is to dishonor him. But high, and low, in this case, is to be understood by comparison to the rate that each man setteth on himself. Dignity. The public worth of a man, which is the value set on him by the commonwealth, is that which men commonly call dignity. And this value of him by the commonwealth, is understood, by offices of command, judicature, public employment, or by names and titles, introduced for distinction of such value. To honor and to see anew. To pray to another, for aid of any kind, is to honor, because a sinya we have an opinion he has power to help, and the more difficult the aid is, the more is the honor. To obey, is to honor, because no man obeys them, whom they think have no power to help, or hurt them. And consequently to disobey, is to disee anewer. To give great gifts to a man, is to honor him, because tis buying of protection, and acknowledging of power. To give little gifts, is to disee anewer, because it is but alms, and signifies an opinion of the need of small helps. To be sedulous in promoting another's good, also to flatter, is to honor, as a sinya we seek his protection or aid. To neglect, is to disee anewer. To give way, or place to another, in any commodity, is to honor, being a confession of greater power. To arrogate, is to disee anewer. To shew any sinya of love, or fear of another, is to honor, for both to love, and to fear, is to value. To contemn, or less to love or fear than he expects, is to disee anewer, for tis undervaluing. To praise, magnify, or call happy, is to honor, because nothing but goodness, power, and felicity is valued. To revile, mock, or pity, is to disee anewer. To speak to another with consideration, to appear before him with decency, and humility, is to honor him, as sinyas of fear to offend. To speak to him rashly, to do anything before him obscenely, slovenly, impudently, is to disee anewer. To believe, to trust, to rely on another, is to honor him, sinya of opinion of his virtue and power. To distrust, or not believe, is to disee anewer. To hearken to a man's counsel, or discourse of what kind soever, is to honor, as a sinya we think him wise, or eloquent, or witty. To sleep, or go forth, or talk the while, is to disee anewer. To do those things to another, which he takes for sinyas of honor, or which the law or custom makes so, is to honor, because in approving the honor done by others, he acknowledgeth the power which others acknowledge. To refuse to do them, is to disee anewer. To agree with in opinion, is to honor, as being a sinya of approving his judgment, and wisdom. To dissent, is disee anewer, and an upbraiding of error, and, if the dissent be in many things, of folly. To imitate, is to honor, for it is vehemently to approve. To imitate one's enemy, is to disee anewer. To honor those another honors, is to honor him, as a sinya of approbation of his judgment. To honor his enemies, is to disee anewer him. To employ in counsel, or in actions of difficulty, is to honor, as a sinya of opinion of his wisdom, or other power. To deny employment in the same cases, to those that seek it, is to disee anewer. All these ways of honoring, are natural, and as well within, as without commonwealths. But in commonwealths, where he, or they that have the supreme authority, can make whatsoever they please, to stand for sinyas of honor, there be other honors. A sovereign doth honor a subject, with whatsoever title, or office, or employment, or action, that he himself will have taken for a sinya of his will to honor him. The king of Persia, honored Mordecai, when he appointed he should be conducted through the streets in the king's garment, upon one of the king's horses, with a crown on his head, and a prince before him, proclaiming, "Thus shall it be done to him that the king will honor." And yet another king of Persia, or the same another time, to one that demanded for some great service, to wear one of the king's robes, gave him leave so to do, but with his addition, that he should wear it as the king's full, and then it was disee anewer. So that of civil honor, such as are magistracy, offices, titles, and in some places coats, and scutcheons painted, and men honor such as have them, as having so many sinyas of favor in the commonwealth, which favor is power. Honorable is whatsoever possession, action, or quality, is an argument and signa of power. And therefore to be honored, loved, or feared of many, is honorable, as arguments of power. To be honored of few or none, dishonorable. Good fortune, if lasting, honorable, as a signa of the favor of God. Ill fortune, and losses, dishonorable. Riches, are honorable, for they are power. Poverty, dishonorable. Magnanimity, liberality, hope, courage, confidence, are honorable, for they proceed from the conscience of power. Pusillanimity, parsimony, fear, diffidence, are dishonorable. Timely resolution, or determination of what a man is to do, is honorable, as being the contempt of small difficulties and dangers. And irresolution, dishonorable, as a signa of too much valuing of little impediments and little advantages, for when a man has weighed things as long as the time permits, and resolves not, the difference of weight is but little, and therefore if he resolve not, he overvalues little things, which is pusillanimity. All actions, and speeches, that proceed, or seem to proceed from much experience, science, discretion, or wit, are honorable, for all these are powers. Actions, or words that proceed from error, ignorance, or folly, dishonorable. Gravity, as for forth as it seems to proceed from a mind employed on something else, is honorable, because employment is a signa of power. But if it seem to proceed from a purpose to appear grave, it is dishonorable. For the gravity of the former, is like the steadiness of a ship laden with merchandise, but of the latter, like the steadiness of a ship ballasted with sand, and other trash. To be conspicuous, that is to say, to be known, for wealth, office, great actions, or any eminent good, is honorable, as a signa of the power for which he is conspicuous. On the contrary, obscurity, is dishonorable. To be descended from conspicuous parents, is honorable, because they the more easily attain the aids and friends of their ancestors. On the contrary, to be descended from obscure parentage, is dishonorable. Actions proceeding from equity, joined with loss, are honorable, as signas of magnanimity, for magnanimity is a signa of power. On the contrary, craft, shifting, neglect of equity, is dishonorable. Nor does it alter the case of honor, whether an action, so it be great and difficult, and consequently a signa of much power, be just or unjust, for honor consisteth only in the opinion of power. Therefore the ancient heathen did not think they dishonored, but greatly honored the gods, when they introduced them in their poems, committing rapes, thefts, and other great, but unjust, or unclean acts, insomuch as nothing is so much celebrated in Jupiter, as his adulteries, nor in Mercury, as his frauds, and thefts, of whose praises, in a hymn of Homer, the greatest is this, that being born in the morning, he had invented music at noon, and before night, stolen away the cattle of Apollo, from his herdsmen. Also amongst men, till there were constituted great commonwealths, it was thought no dishonor to be a pirate, or a highway thief, but rather a lawful trade, not only amongst the Greeks, but also amongst all other nations, as is manifest by the histories of antient time. And at this day, in this part of the world, private duels are, and always will be honorable, though unlawful, till such time as there shall be honor ordained for them that refuse, and ignominy for them that make the challenge. For duels also are many times effects of courage, and the ground of courage is always strength or skill, which are power, though for the most part they be effects of rash speaking, and of the fear of dishonor, in one, or both the combatants, who engaged by rashness, are driven into the lists to avoid disgrace. Scutcheons, and coats of armes hereditary, where they have any eminent privileges, are honorable, otherwise not, for their power consisteth either in such privileges, or in riches, or some such thing as is equally honored in other men. This kind of honor, commonly called gentry, has been derived from the antient Germans. For there never was any such thing known, where the German customs were unknown. Nor is it now anywhere in use, where the Germans have not inhabited. The antient Greek commanders, when they went to war, had their shields painted with such devices as they pleased, insomuch as an unpainted buckler was a signa of poverty, and of a common soldier, but they transmitted not the inheritance of them. The Romans transmitted the marks of their families, but they were the images, not the devices of their ancestors. Amongst the people of Asia, Africa, and America, there is not, nor was ever, any such thing. The Germans only had that custom, from whom it has been derived into England, France, Spain, and Italy, when in great numbers they either aided the Romans, or made their own conquests in these western parts of the world. For Germany, being antiently, as all other countries, in their beginnings, divided amongst an infinite number of little lords, or masters of families, that continually had wars one with another, those masters, or lords, principally to the end they might, when they were covered with arms, be known by their followers, and partly for ornament, both painted their armor, or their scutcheon, or coat, with the picture of some beast, or other thing, and also put some eminent and visible mark upon the crest of their helmets. And his ornament both of the armes, and crest, descended by inheritance to their children, to the eldest pure, and to the rest with some note of diversity, such as the old master, that is to say in Dutch, the Heer Alt thought fit. But when many such families, joined together, made a greater monarchy, this duty of the herald, to distinguish scutcheons, was made a private office apart. And the issue of these lords, is the great and antient gentry, which for the most part bear living creatures, noted for courage and rapine, or castles, battlements, belts, weapons, bars, palisados, and other notes of war, nothing being then in honor, but virtue military. Afterwards, not only kings, but popular commonwealths, gave divers manners of scutcheons, to such as went forth to the war, or returned from it, for encouragement, or recompense to their service. All which, by an observing reader, may be found in such ancient histories, Greek and Latin, as make mention of the German nation, and manners, in their times. Titles of honor. Titles of honor, such as are Duke, Count, Marquis, and Baron, are honorable, as signifying the value set upon them by the sovereign power of the Commonwealth, which titles, were in old time titles of office, and command, derived some from the Romans, some from the Germans, and French. Dukes, in Latin duces, being generals in war, counts, comites, such as bear the general company out of friendship, and were left to govern and defend places conquered, and pacified, marquises, marchiones, were counts that governed the marches, or bounds of the empire. Which titles of duke, count, and marquis, came into the empire, about the time of Constantine the Great, from the customs of the German militia. But baron, seems to have been a title of the Gauls, and signifies a great man, such as were the kings, or princes' men, whom they employed in war about their persons, and seems to be derived from vir, to bur, and bar, that signified the same in the language of the Gauls, that vir in Latin, and thence to baro, and baro, so that such men were called barons, and after barons, and, in Spanish, varones. But he that would know more particularly the original of titles of honor, may find it, as I have done this, in Mr. Selden's most excellent treatise of that subject. In PROCESE of time these offices of honor, by occasion of trouble, and for reasons of good and peaceable government, were turned into mere titles, serving for the most part, to distinguish the precedence, place, and order of subjects in the Commonwealth, and men were made dukes, counts, marquises, and barons of places, wherein they had neither possession nor command, and other titles also, were devised to the same end. Worthiness fitness. Worthiness, is a thing different from the worth, or value of a man, and also from his merit, or desert, and consisteth in a particular power, or ability for that, whereof he is said to be worthy, which particular ability, is usually named fitness, or aptitude. For he is worthiest to be a commander, to be a judge, or to have any other charge, that is best fitted, with the qualities required to the well discharging of it, and worthiest of riches, that has the qualities most requisite for the well using of them, any of which qualities being absent, one may nevertheless be a worthy man, and valuable for something else. Again, a man may be worthy of riches, office, and employment, that nevertheless, can plead no right to have it before another, and therefore cannot be said to merit or deserve it. For merit, presupposeth a right, and that the thing deserved is due by promise, of which I shall say more hereafter, when I shall speak of contracts. Chapter 11. Of the difference of manners. What is here meant by manners? By manners, I mean not here, decency of behavior, as how one man should salute another, or how a man should wash his mouth, or pick his teeth before company, and such other points of the small morals, but those qualities of mankind, that concern their living together in peace, and unity. To which end we are to consider, that the felicity of this life, consisteth not in the repose of a mind satisfied. For there is no such finis ultimus, utmost I'm, nor summum bonum, greatest good, as is spoken of in the books of the old moral philosophers. Nor can a man any more live, whose desires are at an end, than he, whose senses and imaginations are at a stand. Felicity is a continual progress of the desire, from one object to another, the attaining of the former, being still but the way to the later. The cause whereof is, that the object of man's desire, is not to enjoy once only, and for one instant of time, but to assure forever, the way of his future desire. And therefore the voluntary actions, and inclinations of all men, tend, not only to the procuring, but also to the assuring of a contented life, and differ only in the way, which ariseth partly from the diversity of passions, in divers men, and partly from the difference of the knowledge, or opinion each one has of the causes, which produce the effect desired. A restless desire of power, in all men. So that in the first place, I put for a general inclination of all mankind, a perpetual and restless desire of power after power, that ceaseth only in death. And the cause of this, is not always that a man hopes for a more intensive delight, than he has already attained to, or that he cannot be content with a moderate power, but because he cannot assure the power and means to live well, which he hath present, without the acquisition of more. And from hence it is, that kings, whose power is greatest, turn their endeavors to the assuring it a home by laws, or abroad by wars, and when that is done, there succeedeth a new desire, in some, of fame from new conquest, in others, of ease and sensual pleasure, in others, of admiration or being flattered for excellence in some art, or other ability of the mind. Love of contention from competition. Competition of riches, honor, command, or other power, inclineth to contention, enmity, and war, because the way of one competitor, to the attaining of his desire, is to kill, subdue, supplant, or repel the other. Particularly, competition of praise, inclineth to a reverence of antiquity. For men contend with the living, not with the dead, to these ascribing more than due, that they may obscure the glory of the other. Civil obedience from love of ease. Desire of ease, and sensual delight, disposeth men to obey a common power, because by such desires, a man doth abandon the protection might be hoped for from his own industry, and labor. From fear of death or wounds. Fear of death, and wounds, disposeth to the same, and for the same reason. On the contrary, needy men, and hardy, not contented with their present condition, as also, all men that are ambitious of military command, are inclined to continue the causes of war, and to stir up trouble and sedition, for there is no honor military but by war, nor any such hope to mend an ill game, as by causing a new shuffle. And from love of arts. Desire of knowledge, and arts of peace, inclineth men to obey a common power, for such desire, containeth a desire of leisure, and consequently protection from some other power than their own. Love of virtue, from love of praise. Desire of praise, disposeth to laudable actions, such as please them whose judgment they value, for of these men whom we contemn also the praises. Desire of fame after death does the same. And though after death, there be no sense of the praise given us on earth, as being joys, that are either swallowed up in the unspeakable joys of heaven, or extinguished in the extreme torments of hell, yet is not such fame vain, because men have a present delight therein, from the foresight of it, and of the benefit that may rebound thereby to their posterity, which though they now see not, yet they imagine, and anything that is pleasure in the sense, the same also is pleasure in the imagination. Hate, from difficulty of requiting great benefits. To have received from one, to whom we think ourselves equal, greater benefits than there is hope to requite, disposeth to counterfeit love, but really secret hatred, and puts a man into the estate of a desperate debtor, that in declining the sight of his creditor, tacitly wishes him there, where he might never see him more. For benefits oblige, and obligation is thraldom, which is to one's equal, hateful. But to have received benefits from one, whom we acknowledge our superior, inclines to love, because the obligation is no new depes Zion, and cheerful acceptation, which men call gratitude, is such an honor done to the obliger, as is taken generally for retribution. Also to receive benefits, though from an equal, or inferior, as long as there is hope of requital, disposeth to love, for in the intention of the receiver, the obligation is of aid, and service mutual, from whence proceedeth an emulation of who shall exceed in benefiting, the most noble and profitable contention possible, wherein the victor is pleased with his victory, and the other revenged by confessing it. And from conscience of deserving to be hated. To have done more hurt to a man, than he can, or is willing to expiate, inclineth the doer to hate the sufferer. For he must expect revenge, or forgive an essay, both which are hateful. Promptness to hurt, from fear. Fear of oppression, disposeth a man to anticipate, or to seek aid by society, for there is no other way by which a man can secure his life and liberty. And from distrust of their own wit. Men that distrust their own subtlety, are in tumult, and sedition, better disposed for victory, than they that suppose themselves wise, or crafty. For these love to consult, the other, fearing to be circumvented, to strike first. And in sedition, men being always in the procinct of battle, to hold together, and use all advantages of force, is a better stratagem, than any that can proceed from subtlety of wit. Vain undertaking from vainglory. Vainglorious men, such as without being conscious to themselves of great sufficiency, delight in supposing themselves gallant men, are inclined only to ostentation, but not to attempt, because when danger or difficulty appears, they look for nothing but to have their insufficiency discovered. Vainglorious men, such as estimate their sufficiency by the flattery of other men, or the fortune of some precedent action, without assured ground of hope from the true knowledge of themselves, are inclined to rash engaging, and in the approach of danger, or difficulty, to retire if they can, because not seeing the way of safety, they will rather hazard their honor, which may be salved with an excuse, than their lives, for which no salve is sufficient. Ambition, from opinion of sufficiency. Men that have a strong opinion of their own wisdom in matter of government, are disposed to ambition. Because without public employment in council or magistracy, the honor of their wisdom is lost. And therefore eloquent speakers are inclined to ambition, for eloquence seemeth wisdom, both to themselves and others. Irresolution, from too great valuing of small matters. Pusillanimity disposeth men to irresolution, and consequently to lose the occasions, and fittest opportunities of action. For after men have been in deliberation till the time of action approach, if it be not then manifest what is best to be done, 'tis a sinya, the difference of motives, the one way and the other, are not great, therefore not to resolve then, is to lose the occasion by weighing of trifles, which is pusillanimity. Frugality, though in poor men a virtue, make the men unapt to achieve such actions, as require the strength of many men at once, for it weakeneth their endeavor, which is to be nourished and kept in vigor by reward. Confidence in others from ignorance of the marks of wisdom and kindness eloquence, with flattery, disposeth men to confide in them that have it, because the former is seeming wisdom, the later seeming kindness. Add to them military reputation, and it disposeth men to adhere, and subject themselves to those men that have them. The two former, having given them caution against danger from him, the latter gives them caution against danger from others. And from the ignorance of natural causes. Want of science, that is, ignorance of causes, disposeth, or rather constraineth a man to rely on the advice, and authority of others. For all men whom the truth concerns, if they rely not on their own, must rely on the opinion of some other, whom they think wiser than themselves, and see not why he should deceive them. And from want of understanding. Ignorance of the signification of words, which is, want of understanding, disposeth men to take on trust, not only the truth they know not, but also the errors, and which is more, the nonsense of them they trust, for neither error, nor nonsense, can without a perfect understanding of words, be detected. From the same it proceedeth, that men give different names, to one and the same thing, from the difference of their own passions, as they that approve a private opinion, call it opinion, but they that mislike it, heresy, and yet heresy signifies no more than private opinion, but has only a greater tincture of choler. From the same also it proceedeth, that men cannot distinguish, without study and great understanding, between one action of many men, and many actions of one multitude, as for example, between the one action of all the senators of Rome in killing Catiline, and the many actions of a number of senators in killing Caesar, and therefore are disposed to take for the action of the people, that which is a multitude of actions done by a multitude of men, led perhaps by the persuasion of one. Adherence to custom, from ignorance of the nature of right and wrong, ignorance of the causes, and original constitution of right, equity, law, and justice, disposeth a man to make custom and example the rule of his actions, in such manner, as to think that unjust which it hath been the custom to punish, and that just, of the impunity and approbation whereof they can produce an example, or, as the lawyers which only use the false measure of justice barbarously call it, a precedent, like little children, that have no other rule of good and evil manners, but the correction they receive from their parents, and masters, save that children are constant to their rule, whereas men are not so, because grown strong, and stubborn, they appeal from custom to reason, and from reason to custom, as it serves their turn, receding from custom when their interest requires it, and setting themselves against reason, as oft as reason is against them, which is the cause, that the doctrine of right and wrong is perpetually disputed, both by the pen and the sword, whereas the doctrine of lines and figures is not so, because men care not, in that subject what be truth, as a thing that crosses no man's ambition, profit, or lust. For I doubt not, but if it had been a thing contrary to any man's right of dominion, or to the interest of men that have dominion, that the three angles of a triangle should be equal to two angles of a square, that doctrine should have been, if not disputed, yet by the burning of all books of geometry, suppressed, as far as he whom it concerned was able. Adherence to private men, from ignorance of the causes of peace, ignorance of remote causes, disposeth men to attribute all events to the causes immediate and instrumental, for these are all the causes they perceive. And hence it comes to pass that in all places, men that are grieved with payments to the public, discharge their anger upon the publicans, that is to say, farmers, collectors, and other officers of the public revenue, and adhere to such as find fault with the public government, and thereby, when they have engaged themselves beyond hope of justification, fall also upon the supreme authority, for fear of punishment, or shame of receiving pardon. Credulity from ignorance of nature. Ignorance of natural causes disposeth a man to credulity, so as to believe many times impossibilities, for such know nothing to the contrary, but that they may be true, being unable to detect the impossibility. And credulity, because men love to be hearkened unto in company, disposeth them to lying, so that ignorance itself without malice, is able to make a man bode to believe lies, and tell them, and sometimes also to invent them. Curiosity to know, from care of future time. Anxiety for the future time, disposeth men to inquire into the causes of things, because the knowledge of them, maketh men the better able to order the present to their best advantage. Natural religion, from the same. Curiosity, or love of the knowledge of causes, draws a man from consideration of the effect, to seek the cause, and again, the cause of that cause, till of necessity he must come to this thought at last, that there is some cause, whereof there is no former cause, but is eternal, which is it men call God. So that it is impossible to make any profound inquiry into natural causes, without being inclined thereby to believe there is one God eternal, though they cannot have any idea of him in their mind, answerable to his nature. For as a man that is born blind, hearing men talk of warming themselves by the fire, and being brought to warm himself by the same, may easily conceive, and assure himself, there is somewhat there, which men call fire, and is the cause of the heat he feels, but cannot imagine what it is like, nor have an idea of it in his mind, such as they have that see it, so also, by the visible things of this world, and their admirable order, a man may conceive there is a cause of them, which men call God, and yet not have an idea, or image of him in his mind. And they that make little, or no inquiry into the natural causes of things, yet from the fear that proceeds from the ignorance itself, of what it is that hath the power to do them much good or harm, are inclined to suppose, and feign unto themselves, several kinds of powers invisible, and to stand in awe of their own imaginations, and in time of distress to invoke them, as also in the time of an expected good success, to give them thanks, making the creatures of their own fancy, their gods. By which means it hath come to pass, that from the innumerable variety of fancy, men have created in the world innumerable sorts of gods. And this fear of things invisible, is the natural seed of that, which every one in himself calleth religion, and in them that worship, or fear that power otherwise than they do, superstition. And this seed of religion, having been observed by many, some of those that have observed it, have been inclined thereby to nourish, dress, and ferment it into laws, and to add to it of their own invention, any opinion of the causes of future events, by which they thought they should best be able to govern others, and make unto themselves the greatest use of their powers. Chapter 12. Of Religion. Religion, in man only. Seeing there are no sinews, nor fruit of religion, but in man only, there is no cause to doubt, but that the seed of religion, is also only in man, and consisteth in some peculiar quality, or at least in some eminent degree thereof, not to be found in other living creatures. First, from his desire of knowing causes. And first, it is peculiar to the nature of man, to be inquisitive into the causes of the events they see, some more, some less, but all men so much, as to be curious in the search of the causes of their own good and evil fortune. From the consideration of the beginning of things. Secondly, upon the sight of anything that hath a beginning, to think also it had a cause, which determined the same to begin, then when it did, rather than sooner or later. From his observation of the sequel of things. Thirdly, whereas there is no other felicity of beasts, but the enjoying of their quotidian food, ease, and lusts, as having little, or no foresight of the time to come, for want of observation, and memory of the order, consequence, and dependence of the things they see, man observeth how one event hath been produced by another, and remembereth in them antecedents and consequence, and when he cannot assure himself of the true causes of things, for the causes of good and evil fortune for the most part are invisible, he supposes causes of them, either such as his own fancy suggesteth, or trusteth to the authority of other men, such as he thinks to be his friends, and wiser than himself. The natural cause of religion, the anxiety of the time to come, the two first, make anxiety. For being assured that there be causes of all things that have arrived hitherto, or shall arrive hereafter, it is impossible for a man, who continually endeavoureth to secure himself against the evil he fears, and procure the good he desireth, not to be in a perpetual solicitude of the time to come, so that every man, especially those that are over-provident, are in an estate like to that of Prometheus. For as Prometheus, which interpreted, is, the prudent man, was bound to the hill Caucasus, a place of large prospect, where, an eagle feeding on his liver, devoured in the day, as much as was repaired in the night, so that man, which looks too far before him, in the care of future time, hath his heart all the day long, gnawed on by fear of death, poverty, or other calamity, and has no repose, nor pause of his anxiety, but in sleep, which makes them fear the power of invisible things. This perpetual fear, always accompanying mankind in the ignorance of causes, as it were in the dark, must needs have for object something. And therefore when there is nothing to be seen, there is nothing to accuse, either of their good, or evil fortune, but some power, or agent invisible, in which sense perhaps it was, that some of the old poets said, that the gods were at first created by humane fear, which spoken of the gods, that is to say, of the many gods of the Gentiles, is very true. But the acknowledging of one God eternal, infinite, and omnipotent, may more easily be derived, from the desire men have to know the causes of natural bodies, and their several virtues, and operations, than from the fear of what was to befall them in time to come. For he that from any effect he seeth come to pass, say, should reason to the next and immediate cause thereof, and from thence to the cause of that cause, and plong himself profoundly in the pursuit of causes, shall at last come to this, that there must be, as even the heathen philosophers confessed, one first mover, that is, a first, and an eternal cause of all things, which is that which men mean by the name of God, and all this without thought of their fortune, the solicitude whereof, both, inclines to fear, and hinders them from the search of the causes of other things, and thereby gives occasion of feigning of as many gods, as there be men that feign them, and suppose them incorporeal. And for the matter, or substance of the invisible agents, so fancied, they could not by natural cogitation, fall upon any other conceit, but that it was the same with that of the soul of man, and that the soul of man, was of the same substance, with that which appeareth in a dream, to one that sleepeth, or in a looking glass, to one that is awake, which, men not knowing that such apparitions are nothing else but creatures of the fancy, think to be real, and external substances, and therefore call them ghosts, as the Latins called them imagines, and umbri, and thought them spirits, that is, thin aerial bodies, and those invisible agents, which they feared, to be like them, save that they appear, and vanish when they please. But the opinion that such spirits were incorporeal, or immaterial, could never enter into the mind of any man by nature, because, though men may put together words of contradictory signification, as spirit and incorporeal, yet they can never have the imagination of anything answering to them, and therefore, men that by their own meditation, arrive to the acknowledgement of one infinite, omnipotent, and eternal God, choose rather to confess he is incomprehensible, and above their understanding, than to define his nature by spirit incorporeal, and then confess their definition to be unintelligible, or if they give him such a title, it is not dogmatically, with intention to make the divine nature understood, but piously, to honor him with attributes, of significations, as remote as they can from the grossness of bodies visible. But know not the way how they affect anything. Then, for the way by which they think these invisible agents wrought their effects, that is to say, what immediate causes they used, in bringing things to pass, say, men that know not what it is that we call causing, that is, almost all men, have no other rule to guess by, but by observing, and remembering what they have seen to precede the like effect at some other time, or times before, without seeing between the antecedent and subsequent event any dependence or connection at all, and therefore, from the like things past, they expect the like things to come, and hope for good or evil luck, superstitiously, from things that have no part at all in the causing of it, as the Athenians did for their war at Lepanto, demand another Phormio, the Pompeian faction for their war in Africa, another Scipio, and others have done in divers other occasions since. In like manner they attribute their fortune to a stander by, to a lucky or unlucky place, to words spoken, especially if the name of God be amongst them, as charming, and conjuring, the liturgy of which is in so much as to believe, they have power to turn a stone into bread, bread into a man, or anything, into anything. But honor them as they honor men. Thirdly, for the worship which naturally men exhibit to powers invisible, it can be no other, but such expressions of their reverence, as they would use towards men, gifts, petitions, thanks, submission of body, considerate addresses, sober behavior, premeditated words, swearing, that is, assuring one another of their promises, by invoking them. Beyond that reason suggesteth nothing, but leaves them either to rest there, or for further ceremonies, to rely on those they believe to be wiser than themselves, and attribute to them all extraordinary events. Lastly, concerning how these invisible powers declare to men the things which shall hereafter come to pass, especially concerning their good or evil fortune in general, or good or ill success in any particular undertaking, men are naturally at a stand, save that using to conjecture of the time to come, by the time past, they are very apt, not only to take casual things, after one or two encounters, for prognostics of the like encounter ever after, but also to believe the like prognostics from other men, of whom they have once conceived a good opinion. Four things, natural seeds of religion. And in these four things, opinion of ghosts, ignorance of second causes, devotion towards what men fear, and taking of things casual for prognostics, consisteth the natural seed of religion, which by reason of the different fancies, judgments, and passions of several men, hath grown up into ceremonies so different, that those which are used by one man, are for the most part ridiculous to another. Made different by culture. For these seeds have received culture from two sorts of men. One sort have been they, that have nourished, and ordered them, according to their own invention. The other, have done it, by God's commandment, and direction, but both sorts have done it, with a purpose to make those men that relied on them, the more apt to obedience, laws, peace, charity, and civil society. So that the religion of the former sort, is a part of humane politiques, and tiac hate part of the duty which earthly kings require of their subjects. And the religion of the later sort is divine politiques, and containeth precepts to those that have yielded themselves subjects in the kingdom of God. Of the former sort, were all the founders of commonwealths, and the lawgivers of the Gentiles. Of the later sort, were Abraham, Moses, and our blessed Savior, by whom have been derived unto us the laws of the kingdom of God. The absurd opinion of gentilisme. And for that part of religion, which consisteth in opinions concerning the nature of powers invisible, there is almost nothing that has a name, that has not been esteemed amongst the Gentiles, in one place or another, a god, or devil, or by their poets feigned to be inanimate, inhabited, or possessed by some spirit or other. The unformed matter of the world, was a god, by the name of Chaos. The heaven, the ocean, the planets, the fire, the earth, the winds, were so many gods. Men, women, a bird, a crocodile, a calf, a dog, a snake, an onion, a leek, deified. Besides, that they filled almost all places, with spirits called daemons, the plains, with pan and panaces, or satyres, the woods, with fauns and nymphs, the sea, with tritons and other nymphs, every river and fountain, with a ghost of his name, and with nymphs, every house, with it lares, or familiars, every man, with his genius, hell, with ghosts and spiritual officers, as Charon, Cerberus, and the Furies, and in the night time, all places with larvae, lemures, ghosts of men deceased, and a whole kingdom of fairies, and bugbears. They have also ascribed divinity, and built temples to mere accidents, and qualities, such as are time, night, day, peace, concord, love, contention, virtue, honor, health, rust, fever, and the like, which when they prayed for, or against, they prayed to, as if there were ghosts of those names hanging over their heads, and letting fall, or withholding that good, or evil, for, or against which they prayed. They invoked also their own wit, by the name of muses, their own ignorance, by the name of fortune, their own lust, by the name of Cupid, their own rage, by the name Furies, their own privy members by the name of Priapus, and attributed their pollutions, to incubi, and succubi, insomuch as there was nothing, which a poet could introduce as a person in his poem, which they did not make either a god, or a devil. The same authors of the religion of the Gentiles, observing the second ground for religion, which is men's ignorance of causes, and thereby their aptness to attribute their fortune to causes, on which there was no dependence at all apparent, took occasion to obtrude on their ignorance, instead of second causes, a kind of second and ministerial gods, ascribing the cause of fecundity, to Venus, the cause of arts, to Apollo, of subtlety and craft, to Mercury, of tempests and storms, to Aeolus, and of other effects, to other gods, insomuch as there was amongst the heathen almost as great variety of gods, as of business. And to the worship, which naturally men conceived fit to be used towards their gods, namely oblations, prayers, thanks, and the rest formerly named, the same legislators of the Gentiles have added their images, both in picture, and sculpture, that the more ignorant sort, that is to say, the most part, or generality of the people, thinking the gods for whose representation they were made, were really included, and as it were housed within them, might so much the more stand in fear of them, and endowed them with lands, and houses, and officers, and revenues, set apart from all other humane uses, that is, consecrated and made holy to those their idols, as caverns, groves, woods, mountains, and whole islands, and have attributed to them, not only the shapes, some of men, some of beasts, some of monsters, but also the faculties, and passions of men and beasts, as sense, speech, sex, lust, generation, and this not only by mixing one with another, to propagate the kind of gods, but also by mixing with men and women, to beget mongrel gods, and but inmates of heaven, as Bacchus, Hercules, and others besides, anger, revenge, and other passions of living creatures, and the actions proceeding from them, as fraud, theft, adultery, sodomy, and any vice that may be taken for an effect of power, or a cause of pleasure, and all such vices, as amongst men are taken to be against law, rather than against honor. Lastly, to the prognostics of time to come, which are naturally, but conjectures upon the experience of time past, and supernatural, divine revelation, the same authors of the religion of the Gentiles, partly upon pretended experience, partly upon pretended revelation, have added innumerable other superstitious ways of divination, and made men believe they should find their fortunes, sometimes in the ambiguous or senseless answers of the priests at Delphi, Delos, Ammon, and other famous oracles, which answers were made ambiguous by design, to own the event both ways, or absurd by the intoxicating vapor of the place, which is very frequent in sulfurous caverns, sometimes in the leaves of the Sibyls, of whose prophecies, like those perhaps of Nostradamus, for the fragments now extant seem to be the invention of later times, there were some books in reputation in the time of the Roman Republic, sometimes in the insignificant speeches of madmen, supposed to be possessed with a divine spirit, which possession they called enthusiasm, and these kinds of foretelling events were accounted theomancy, or prophecy, sometimes in the aspect of the stars at their nativity, which was called horoscopy, and esteemed a part of judiciary astrology, sometimes in their own hopes and fears, called themomancy, or presage, sometimes in the prediction of witches, that pretended conference with the dead, which is called necromancy, conjuring, and witchcraft, and is but juggling and confederate knavery, sometimes in the casual flight, or feeding of birds, called augury, sometimes in the entrails of a sacrificed beast, which was a ruspicina, sometimes in dreams, sometimes in croaking of ravens, or chattering of birds, sometimes in the lineaments of the face, which was called metoposcopa, or by palmistry in the lines of the hand, in casual words, called omina, sometimes in monsters, or unusual accidents, as eclipses, comets, rare meteors, earthquakes, inundations, uncouth births, and the like, which they called portenta and ostenta, because they thought them to portend, or foreshew some great calamity to come, sometimes, in mere lottery, as cross and pile, counting holes in a sieve, dipping of verses in Homer and Virgil, and innumerable other such vain conceits. So easy are men to be drawn to believe anything, from such men as have gotten credit with them, and can with gentleness, and dexterity, take hold of their fear, and ignorance. The designs of the authors of the religion of the heathen and therefore the first founders, and legislators of commonwealths amongst the Gentiles, whose ends were only to keep the people in obedience, and peace, have in all places taken care, first, to imprint in their minds a belief, that those precepts which they gave concerning religion, might not be thought to proceed from their own device, but from the dictates of some god, or other spirit, or else that they themselves were of a higher nature than mere mortals, that their laws might the more easily be received. So Numa Pompilius pretended to receive the ceremonies he instituted amongst the Romans, from the Nymphagiria, and the first king and founder of the kingdom of Peru, pretended himself and his wife to be the children of the sun, and Muhammad, to set up his new religion, pretended to have conferences with the Holy Ghost, in for me of a dove. Secondly, they have had a care, to make it believed, that the same things were displeasing to the gods, which were forbidden by the laws. Thirdly, to prescribe ceremonies, supplications, sacrifices, and festivals, by which they were to believe, the anger of the gods might be appeased, and that ill success in war, great contagions of sickness, earthquakes, and each man's private misery, came from the anger of the gods, and their anger from the neglect of their worship, or the forgetting, or mistaking some point of the ceremonies required. And though amongst the antient Romans, men were not forbidden to deny, that which in the poets is written of the pains, and pleasures after this life, which divers of great authority, and gravity in that state have in their harangues openly derided, yet that belief was always more cherished, than the contrary. And by these, and such other institutions, they obtained in order to their end, which was the peace of the commonwealth, that the common people in their misfortunes, laying the fault on neglect, or error in their ceremonies, or on their own disobedience to the laws, were the less apt to mutiny against their governors. And being entertained with the pomp, and pastime of festivals, and public gomes, made in honor of the gods, needed nothing else but bread, to keep them from discontent, murmuring, and commotion against the state. And therefore the Romans, that had conquered the greatest part of the then known world, made no scruple of tolerating any religion whatsoever in the city of Rome itself, unless it had something in it, that could not consist with their civil government, nor do we read, that any religion was there forbidden, but that of the Jews, who, being the peculiar kingdom of God, thought it unlawful to acknowledge subjection to any mortal king or state whatsoever. And thus you see how the religion of the Gentiles was a part of their policy. The true religion, and the laws of God's kingdom the same, but where God himself, by supernatural revelation, planted religion, there he also made to himself a peculiar kingdom, and gave laws, not only of behavior towards himself, but also towards one another, and thereby in the kingdom of God, the policy and laws civil, are a part of religion, and therefore the distinction of temporal and spiritual domination hath there no place. It is true that God is king of all the earth, yet may he be king of a peculiar and chosen nation. For there is no more incongruity therein, than that he that hath the general command of the whole army, should have withal a peculiar regiment, or company of his own. God is king of all the earth by his power, but of his chosen people, he is king by covenant. but to speak more largely of the kingdom of God, both by nature, and covenant, I have in the following discourse assigned an other place. The causes of change in religion. From the propagation of religion, it is not hard to understand the causes of the resolution of the same into its first seeds, or principles, which are only an opinion of a deity, and powers invisible, and supernatural, that can never be so abolished out of humane nature, but that new religions may again be made to spring out of them, by the culture of such men, as for such purpose are in reputation. Foreseeing all formed religion, is founded at first, upon the faith which a multitude hath in some one person, whom they believe not only to be a wise man, and to labor to procure their happiness, but also to be a holy man, to whom God himself vouchsafeth to declare his will supernaturally, it followeth necessarily, when they that have the government of religion, shall come to have either the wisdom of those men, their sincerity, or their love suspected, or that they shall be unable to shew any probable token of divine revelation, that the religion which they desire to uphold, must be suspected likewise, and, without the fear of the civil sword, contradicted and rejected. Enjoining belief of impossibilities. That which taketh away the reputation of wisdom, in him that formeth a religion, or addeth to it when it is already formed, is the enjoining of a belief of contradictories, for both parts of a contradiction cannot possibly be true, and therefore to enjoin the belief of them, is an argument of ignorance, which detects the author in that, and discredits him in all things else he shall propound as from revelation supernatural, which revelation a man may indeed have of many things above, but of nothing against natural reason. Doing contrary to the religion they establish. That which taketh away the reputation of sincerity, is the doing, or saying of such things, as appear to be sinews, that what they require other men to believe, is not believed by themselves, all which doings, or sayings are therefore called scandalous, because they be stumbling blocks, that make men to fall in the way of religion, as injustice, cruelty, profaneness, avarice, and luxury. For who can believe, that he that doth ordinarily such actions, as proceed from any of these roots, believeth there is any such invisible power to be feared, as he affrighteth other men withal, for lesser faults. That which taketh away the reputation of love, is the being detected of private ends, as when the belief they require of others, conduceth, or seemeth to conduce to the acquiring of dominion, riches, dignity, or secure pleasure, to themselves only, or specially. For that which men reap benefit by to themselves, they are thought to do for their own sakes, and not for love of others. Want of the testimony of miracles. Lastly, the testimony that men can render of divine calling, can be no other, than the operation of miracles, or true prophecy, which also is a miracle or extraordinary felicity. And therefore, to those points of religion, which have been received from them that did such miracles, those that are added by such, as approve not their calling by some miracle, obtain no greater belief, than what the custom, and laws of the places, in which they be educated, have wrought into them. For as in natural things, men of judgment require natural sinews, and arguments, so in supernatural things, they require sinews supernatural, which are miracles, before they consent inwardly, and from their hearts. All which causes of the weakening of men's faith, do manifestly appear in the examples following. First, we have the example of the children of Israel, who when Moses, that had approved his calling to them by miracles, and by the happy conduct of them out of Egypt, was absent but 40 days, revolted from the worship of the true God, recommended to them by him, and setting up, Exodus 32:1-2, a golden calf for their God, relapsed into the idolatry of the Egyptians, from whom they had been so lately delivered. And again, after Moses, Aaron, Joshua, and that generation which had seen the great works of God in Israel, Judges 2:11, were dead, another generation arose, and served Baal. So that miracles failing, faith also failed. Again, when the sons of Samuel, 1 Sam 8:3, being constituted by their father judges in Beersheba, received bribes, and judged unjustly, the people of Israel refused any more to have God to be their king, in other manner than he was king of other people, and therefore cried out to Samuel, to choose them a king after the manner of the nations. So that justice failing, faith also failed, insomuch, as they deposed their God, from reigning over them. And whereas in the planting of Christian religion, the oracle ceased in all parts of the Roman Empire, and the number of Christians increased wonderfully every day, and in every place, by the preaching of the apostles, and evangelists, a great part of that success, may reasonably be attributed, to the contempt, into which the priests of the Gentiles of that time, had brought themselves, by their uncleanness, avarice, and juggling between princes. Also the religion of the Church of Rome, was partly, for the same cause abolished in England, and many other parts of Christendom, insomuch, as the failing of virtue in the pastors, make faith fail in the people, and partly from bringing of the philosophy, and doctrine of Aristotle into religion, by the schoolmen, from whence there arose so many contradictions, and absurdities, as brought the clergy into a reputation both of ignorance, and of fraudulent intention, and inclined people to revolt from them, either against the will of their own princes, as in France and Holland, or with their will, as in England. Lastly, amongst the points by the Church of Rome declared necessary for salvation, there be so many, manifestly to the advantage of the Pope, and of his spiritual subjects, residing in the territories of other Christian princes, that were it not for the mutual emulation of those princes, they might without war, or trouble, exclude all foreign authority, as easily as it has been excluded in England. For who is there that does not see, to whose benefit it conduceth, to have it believed, that a king hath not his authority from Christ, unless a bishop crown him? That a king, if he be a priest, cannot marry? That whether a prince be born in lawful marriage, or not, must be judged by authority from Rome? That subjects may be freed from their allegiance, if by the court of Rome, the king be judged an heretic? That a king, as Chilperic of France, may be deposed by a pope, as Pope Zachary, for no cause, and his kingdom given to one of his subjects? That the clergy, and regulars, in what country soever, shall be exempt from the jurisdiction of their king, in cases criminal? Or who does not see, to whose profit redound the fees of private masses, and veils of purgatory, with other sinews of private interest, enough to mortify the most lively faith, if, as I said, the civil magistrate, and custom did not more sustain it, than any opinion they have of the sanctity, wisdom, or probity of their teachers. So that I may attribute all the changes of religion in the world, to one and the same cause, and that is, unpleasing priests, and those not only amongst Catholics, but even in that church that hath presumed most of Reformation.